It is such a joy and privilege to be able to open up God's Word with you this morning. I am extremely thankful for this seminary. This now marks my 8th year in seminary. Just can't get enough TMS. I love it so much. It has been a huge, huge blessing. I am so thankful for all of my professors who have been patient with me, who have loved me and cared for me, taught me, equipped me, poured into me, and really discipled me. So it's been a rich, rich blessing to be a part of this seminary and to be trained here. Well, to begin, I want to tell you about Albert Einstein, possibly the smartest man who ever lived. He's probably most famous for his work in formulating the equation E equals MC squared, and his achievements in the realm of scientific philosophy and physics have made the name Einstein synonymous with genius. But what's little known about Einstein was that at age 24, he got married to a woman named Mileva. And what's even lesser known is the nature of their relationship. Well, a letter surfaced, a letter written from Einstein to his wife that gave us a little glimpse into the Einstein household. And this letter was not really a letter at all. It was more of a contract in which Einstein laid out the rules for how he and his wife were to interact with each other. And as amazing and shocking as Einstein's achievements were, this letter is even more amazing and even more shocking. Let me read a little bit to you. This is Einstein to his wife. "You will make sure that my clothes and laundry are kept in good order. You will make sure that I receive my 3 meals regularly in my room. You will make sure that my bedroom and study are kept neat, and especially that my desk is left for my use only." She's not even in seminary. "You will renounce all personal relations with me insofar as they are not completely necessary for social reasons. Specifically, you will forego my sitting at home with you and my going out traveling with you. You will leave my bedroom or study immediately without protest if I request it. You will stop talking to me if I request it." This guy sounds like he needs Ray Maringer's morning class on how to love your wife. Albert Einstein, the smartest man who ever lived. But he doesn't have a clue about love. And this morning, we're going to look at a passage where we see the opposite of what we get in Albert Einstein. Now, this morning, we're going to see compassionate, tender, caring, and enduring love. We're going to look at a passage that reminds us of God's compassion for his bride. Turn with me to Hosea chapter 11. Hosea chapter 11. Hosea was a prophet who was charged to do something unique, to marry a prostitute and to love her with an enduring love. A picture of Israel's unfaithfulness to God and yet God's enduring love for Israel. Hosea chapter 11. And we're going to look at verses 1 to 11 today. Verse 12 begins a new section and fits better with chapter 12. In fact, if you have your BHS with you or your reader's Bible, you'll see that the Hebrew text cuts off Hosea 11 at verse 11. And verse 12 is a part of chapter 12. And so we're going to stop at verse 11. Hosea chapter 11. "When Israel was a youth, I loved him. And out of Egypt, I called my son. The more they called them, the more they went from them. They kept sacrificing to the Baals and burning incense to idols. Yet it is I who taught Ephraim to walk. I took them in my arms. But they did not know that I healed them. I led them with cords of a man, with bonds of love. And I became to them as one who lifts the yoke from their jaws, and I bent down and fed them. They will not return to the land of Egypt, but Assyria, he will be their king. because they refuse to return to me. The sword will whirl against their cities and will demolish their gate bars and consume them because of their counsels. So my people are bent on turning from me. Though they call them to the one on high, none at all exalts him. How can I give you up, O Ephraim? How can I surrender you, O Israel? How can I make you like Admah? How can I treat you like Zeboim? My heart is turned over within me. All my compassions are kindled. I will not execute my fierce anger. I will not destroy Ephraim again. For I am God and not a man, the Holy One in your midst, and I will not come in wrath. They will walk after the Lord. He will roar like a lion. Indeed, he will roar. And his sons will come trembling from the west. They will come trembling like birds from Egypt and like doves from the land of Assyria, and I will settle them in their houses, declares the Lord. Hosea ministered during the divided kingdom and was a prophet to the northern kingdom in the 8th century BC from around 754 to 714 BC. Now, why is that important? Because in that span of time, you have 722 BC, the Assyrian invasion of the northern kingdom. And that's going to be important for our text today. The northern kingdom was the more evil of the two. They didn't even have one single good king recorded in scripture. The south had a few good kings. And the wickedness of the northern kings only reflected the wickedness of the people. Now, let me just give you a sample here. Turn over to chapter 4, verses 1 to 2. Hosea 4, starting in verse 1. Listen to the word of the Lord, O sons of Israel, for the Lord has a case against the inhabitants of the land, because there is no faithfulness or kindness or knowledge of God in the land. There is swearing, deception, murder, stealing, and adultery. They employ violence so that bloodshed follows bloodshed. Sin was rampant in Israel. Chapter 4, verse 9 says that even the priests were corrupt. Chapter 5, verse 5, the people were arrogant. Chapter 7, verse 5, the princes and kings burned with lust. 9, 7, the prophets were mad fools. 10, 2, their hearts were false. Israel did not fear the Lord. They did not truly know the Lord. They did not trust in the Lord. They trusted in their pagan sacrifices. They trusted in their idols. They trusted in themselves. They trusted even in their enemies. Israel had public sin and private sin, corporate sin and individual sin, sin by their leaders, sin by their followers. Israel had sinned in 100 different ways, and the worst part of it all was that in the midst of all this sin, Israel continued to put on their Sunday best and go to church. Turn over to chapter 6, verse 6, a verse that will sound familiar. Hosea 6, 6, for I delight in loyalty rather than sacrifice, and in the knowledge of God rather than burnt offerings. Israel lived a double life, debauchery on Saturday night, and then worship at church on Sunday morning. But all of this worship was just for show. And that's why Jesus uses this verse to quote about the Pharisees. All of this sin is summarized in a haunting statement in verse 10, 6:10. In the house of Israel, I have seen a horrible thing. Ephraim's harlotry is there. Israel has defiled itself. Israel is guilty of spiritual harlotry. They pledged themselves to God, and yet they were unfaithful to him. But in spite of all this, in spite of all this spiritual adultery, we have Hosea chapter 11, a love story between God and his covenant people. A sinful people for sure, but his covenant people nonetheless. This love story isn't one that you would see in a typical romantic comedy or Disney movie where the prince and princess fall in love and live happily ever after, because this love story is completely and totally lopsided. This story ends in happily ever after, not because Israel loves God, but because God's love is powerful enough to overcome all obstacles, because as we'll see, God's love is one that simply will not let Israel go. And I hope you see your story here as well. I hope that we'll be reminded of just how lopsided our love story was when it began, when God saved us while we were yet sinners, and how lopsided sometimes it still is, even after our conversion. And I hope that we'll all be comforted with the truth that God's love in Jesus Christ is a love that will not let us go. Let's turn back to chapter 11. Today, we're going to organize this passage under three headings. God's love recalled, verses 1 to 4. God's love rejected, verses 5 to 7. And God's love reaffirmed, verses 8 to 11. God's love recalled, rejected, and then reaffirmed. First, God's love recalled, verses 1 to 4. Now, these four verses are Israel's reminder of God's love for them. Let's read verse 1. When Israel was a youth, I loved him, and out of Egypt I called my son. Here is Israel's reminder from God. From the very beginning, when you were just a youth, just a child, I loved you. From the very beginning, when Israel was just a group of slaves in Egypt, God loved them and saw them as sons. As you might know, this verse is quoted in Matthew 2:15 to refer to Jesus. Out of Egypt, I called my son. I remember how King Herod decreed that all the male babies 2 years old or under were to be slaughtered, and so Joseph and Mary have to take Jesus and flee to Egypt. And it's not until Herod dies that Joseph and Mary are able to take Jesus out of Egypt back to the land of Nazareth. And it's at that point that Matthew says, out of Egypt I called my son. You see, as Matthew sits down to reflect back on this incident in the life of Christ, he sees analogy. He sees foreshadowing. He sees typology. And there are at least two points of analogy between Israel and Jesus. First of all, they're both called sons of God. And secondly, they're both called out of Egypt at a young age. But while we see typology here, the parallelism between Jesus and Israel, the analogy that's seen between Jesus and Israel is most clearly seen in how they are opposites of one another. You see, Jesus was everything Israel was supposed to be, but was not. Israel was called out of Egypt to obey God's law given to them at Sinai, to serve God, love God, and to therefore be a light to the nations and bring salvation to the ends of the earth. But they failed in all respects. Jesus, on the other hand, perfectly obeyed God, perfectly served God, perfectly loved God, and is the light of the world that brings salvation to the ends of the world. And so Jesus succeeded where Israel failed. The nation ended up being sinful, selfish, and idolatrous, while Jesus was just the opposite. And yet, both the nation and Jesus are given the same title, sons of God. And that's the point. Israel, in spite of all their sin, is given the same title as the Messiah, nothing less than the beloved sons of God. So God loved Israel as his own son, despite the fact that, as verse 2 says, the more they called them, the more they went from them. They kept sacrificing to the Baals and burning incense to idols. Yes, God loved them from the beginning, but from the beginning, they were rebellious. Who's doing the calling in verse 2? Who is the they in verse 2? It's a reference to the prophets of God. God's love pursued his people through the prophets, who generation after generation after generation called the people to repent. Turn from your Baal worship toward the one true living God, Yahweh. Verse 2 is so sad. The more prophets God sent, the further away Israel went. The louder the voice of God got in their ear, the more they tuned him out. God kept calling, and they kept running. And in their darkest periods in their history, they picked up stones and murdered those prophets. But God's love doesn't give up so easily. Like a good parent doesn't give up on his son. Verse 3. Yet it is I who taught Ephraim to walk. Ephraim is another name for Israel. I took them in my arms, but they did not know that I healed them. This language is so tender, so precious. I taught my son Ephraim how to walk. I'll never forget the moment that I saw my son, Nathaniel, walk for the first time. In the weeks leading up to it, I did what this passage said. I took Nathaniel's little hands and put them in my hands and propped him up, supported him, and walked along with him, just guided him and allowed him to take some steps. And then one day I was sitting on the couch and he was sitting on the floor. My wife was in another room. She missed it. And my son Nathaniel stands up and just gives me the slightest little smile as if to say, check this out, Dad. And he takes his first two steps. Now, the average baby walks at 1 year old. Nathaniel walked when he was 11 months old. So I thought, all right, on his way to the NBA. So this language of God teaching Israel to walk is so tender and so compassionate. And then God changes the illustration from a baby to that of a farm animal in verse 4. He doesn't treat this animal like a beast, but a pet. He loves this animal. Look, it says that he led them. Not dragged or pulled or forced. He doesn't poke and prod them like you're supposed to do with farm animals. But what does it say? I led them with cords of a man, with bonds of love. Now then verse 4 talks about how the animal has a heavy yoke on it, but he takes it off. He doesn't just throw food in the pail for the animal to eat, but he bends down to feed it. But in spite of all of this love, and all of this care, verse 3, at the end there, but they did not know that I healed them. I loved you. I took you in my arms. I taught you to walk. But you forgot. You had no idea that I did this for you. And so God helps them recall his love. He reminds them that he is their father, they are his sons, and that he loves them. I think we can see this kind of love in Pastor Lee Jong-ruk, a pastor in Seoul, South Korea. His story is told in the documentary The Dropbox. Some of you may have seen it. It came out a few years ago. Not the kind of Dropbox that some of you guys are thinking about. It's not the online sharing Dropbox. This is a documentary. This is a story about a pastor in Seoul. A Seoul, like a number of other major cities, has a major problem. Young and desperate mothers abandon their unwanted babies in the streets, leaving them to die. In Seoul, over 200 babies a year are found dead in dumpsters, bathrooms, and alleyways. Many of these babies have birth defects, either physical or mental, deformed limbs or facial features, autism and Down syndrome. Experts say that the problem is even worse in Seoul than in other major cities because of Korea's emphasis on physical perfection and physical beauty. One night, a neighbor found an abandoned baby still living, and Pastor Lee and his wife took this child in, a little girl, and adopted her as their own. And this sparked an idea with Pastor Lee. He made this drop box outside of his house, this baby box, this padded and heated box where desperate mothers could anonymously abandon their babies and he would take them in. He designed the box to have a little bell on it so that when a baby was dropped in, the bell would ring. And he remembers when that first bell rung, he quickly ran over to the box. A little girl. He remembers picking up that little girl and carrying her and saying, "Thank you, Lord." A few days later, the bell rang again. And again. And again. And again. Today, over 650 babies have been saved by the baby box, from newborns to a three-year-old who was too big to fit in the box, and so they just left him on the porch. And while most of these children are transferred to orphanages, Pastor Lee and his wife have adopted 15 of them on their own. 15! You thought some of these guys in seminaries had big families. And all 15 of these have special needs and disabilities. And Pastor Lee says it's difficult to have 15 dependent children living in the house, but he describes it as a house full of joy. Friends, do you see yourself in this? You are the baby in the box, disabled by sin, completely unable to save yourself, helpless. And yet God comes to rescue you, takes you into his arms, takes you into his own family, calls you his son, and teaches you how to walk your first steps. The question is, will you remember this love? Men, in our churches, in our families, and in our hearts, we must never forget the warmth of God's love. What a shame. What a tragedy if we were to forget this love, or even worse, act like it never happened, which is exactly what Israel does. They flat out reject his love. Secondly, we see in this text, God's love rejected, verses 5-7. First, God's love recalled, and now it is rejected. Verse 5, they will not return to the land of Egypt, but Assyria, he will be their king, because they refuse to return to me. The sword will whirl against their cities and will demolish their gate bars and consume them because of their counsels. Israel returned love with unfaithfulness, loyalty with disloyalty. This baby grew up to be the rebellious teenager who hates his dad. And for their sin, God's going to bring judgment on them. This time, they're not going to go to Egypt for their captivity. They're going to go to Assyria, this next-door neighbor that was growing more and more powerful by the minute. Notice that verses 5 and 6 have a ring of finality. Verse 5, Assyria, he will be their king. Verse 6, the sword will whirl against their cities. As you're reading through other prophetic books, you might remember it a little bit differently. We're used to hearing, for instance, Isaiah 1, 19 to 20, if you are willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. But if you refuse and rebel, you will be eaten by the sword. That's what we're more used to reading, right? That key word, if. If you rebel, then I will punish you, but if you obey and if you repent, I'll bless you. But that's not what we see here. We read Assyria will be your king. You see, we're too late in the game. Israel has had centuries to repent. This is already the 700s BC. The bell has tolled. The clock has struck midnight. It's too late for Israel to repent. Judgment is certain. God's love is great, but he cannot take sin lightly. I told you, men, to never forget the warmth of God's love. But I also say to you, never forget the fire of God's judgment. Both are real. Both are intense. And notice, though, that Israel is not doomed ultimately for their sin. No, they're doomed because they refuse to repent. Verse 5, they will not return to the land of Egypt, but Assyria, he will be their king because they refused to return to me. Sin is a problem, but God will forgive sin. God will take your sin as far as the east is from the west. If you turn from it, if you repent, if you come home to him, the problem is when you refuse to repent. Israel was to turn away from their swearing, lying, murder, stealing, and adultery so that they can turn toward God. But instead, verse 7 says that they were bent on turning away from him. So, what next? Judgment, right? That's what you would expect after this pronouncement of Israel's sin. My second point was God's love rejected. And so you would expect, point three logically should be God's love rescinded, God's love retracted. But instead you get just the opposite. Instead, we have, shockingly, God's love reaffirmed. God's love reaffirmed, verses 8 to 11. Let's read verse 8. God cries out, "How can I give you up, O Ephraim? How can I surrender you, O Israel? How can I make you like Adma? How can I treat you like Zeboim? My heart is turned over within me. All my compassions are kindled." Hosea 11 is a tale of terrible sin and judgment, but as we've said, it's also a love story. God looks down on his people in their sin, and he's about to pour out wrath on them, but he stops short. Because the idea of pouring out that wrath on them is repulsive to him. Now, what are these cities, Adma and Zeboim? Well, if you were to go back to Deuteronomy 29:23, you'd find that they, along with the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah, were completely burned with fire and brimstone. No survivor was left. They were wiped off the map. Today, there is no city called Adma or Zeboim or any modern equivalent. So the names Adma and Zeboim became synonymous with annihilation, a complete and total annihilation. But God looks at Israel and says, "How can I do that to you? How can I give you up? How can I hand you over, my people, my sons?" So God takes them to the brink of annihilation, but stops short and says, "I can't do it. I can't do it." He allows Assyria to cross their borders and do brutal acts of violence and take many of them away into captivity. But he also allows a few survivors to remain. And many years later, he allows the people of Israel to return back to their land and they can start their nation over again. Today, there is no Adma and there is no Zeboim, but there is a nation called Israel. Why? Because, as we'll see in verse 8, because my heart is turned over within me. All my compassions are kindled. This verse puts God's heart on the table for all to see. It shows God's emotions, his passion, his affection. If God's love has grown cold in your heart, if you're ever tempted to think that God's love is something that is distant or abstract, this verse is a solution. Here is the love of God in vivid and raw emotion. Verse 8 says that his heart is turned over within him. The language is so vivid, so graphic. Israel moves the heart of God. In fact, it says that God loves Israel so much that his heart flips over in his chest. It says all his compassions are kindled. All of his affections are kindled. All of his love is awakened. Every capacity to love has been ignited. Love overflows in every corner of God's heart for his people. I think we've heard about and even preached about the love of God so often that, at times at least, it ceases to move us. That just doesn't seem very real to us. It seems kind of distant, foggy. Just something that we say, of course, in counseling and in preaching, because we're church leaders. But this passage reminds us that the love of God is not distant. It's not some factual and boring doctrine you would read about in a systematic theology. It's not just a part of our theology curriculum and something that we write about in our research papers. No, the love of God burns within his heart. It is something that he feels and something that he experiences and therefore should be something that we feel and we experience. If we understand the love of God rightly, it pushes us and pulls us. It moves us. It compels us. I look at his love in action in verse 9. I will not execute my fierce anger. I will not destroy Ephraim again, for I am God and not a man, the Holy One in your midst, and I will not come in wrath. God doesn't execute his anger. Whereas a man would look at the debauchery of Israel and how they spurned their loving father, any man would say, Adma, Zeboim, make them like them, get rid of them. But God said he is not like a man. He is the Holy One. He is separate. He is in a category all by himself. There is no one like him. He's in a category by himself. There is no one like him. In his mercy. Any man would give up on these people, but God doesn't. Now you got to remember the sequence of events here. Hosea has just pronounced judgment on the people in verses 1 to 7. They know they're guilty, and they know that they're headed toward judgment at 100 miles per hour, but then in verse 8, God slams the brakes. Imagine being on death row. You're a convicted criminal. You know you're guilty. That's the olden times, and you're sentenced to death by firing squad. And so they take you out of your prison cell and lead you out to the yard, and you see 12 soldiers standing before you, each with a rifle. And that's the last thing that you see because the captain puts a blindfold on your eyes and you can't see anything. And you hear the captain count down. 5. 4, 3, 2, 1. Nothing. You feel the captain take the blindfold off, and he says, you're free. You're forgiven. Expecting judgment, but finding forgiveness instead. Is that not our story? Thinking about our life of sin and everything that we've done, we were heading toward judgment at 100 miles per hour, but God, in his mercy, slams the brakes. One pastor writes that this is to experience looking in your judge's face and finding a savior there. And this Savior saves completely. Let's keep reading in verse 10. They will walk after the Lord. He will roar like a lion. Indeed, he will roar, and his sons will come trembling from the west. They will come trembling like birds from Egypt and like doves from the land of Assyria, and I will settle them in their houses, declares the Lord. Here is God's love in action. Deliverance. At some point in the future, Israel will walk after the Lord. They will follow him. Verses 10 and 11 say that they will come trembling, which is a good thing in this context, as they finally approach God with the awe and reverence that they should have instead of their prideful, stuck-up noses that they had before. We're not given details about how the people will change. This passage says nothing about the forgiveness of sins or a transformed heart, although from other prophetic passages, we know that to be the case. Here it just gives the big picture. God will roar like a lion in power, and his people will follow him. What a great picture, right? The king of the jungle roars, and all of the animals follow him. This prophecy alludes to the second coming of Christ, when he establishes his kingdom. According to Dr. MacArthur, in commenting on this verse, quote, returns from Assyrian and Babylonian captivities were from the east. This undoubtedly has reference to the return at the second advent to help set up the millennial kingdom when he calls Israel from their dispersion and reverses the judgment of Hosea 9:17, end quote. Now, this goes beyond the merciful return from Assyria. This looks ahead to an even more merciful and final return to the land. Jesus comes again. The Messiah comes again and finally, once and for all, returns the people to their land, to their houses, as it says in verse 11. Why bless this corrupt nation? Because as we saw all the way back in verse 1, these are his sons. God calls these people his sons, and he will not go back on this calling. In the same way that we, even as imperfect fathers, will never stop loving our children. Now, perhaps the greatest illustration of this passage is the life of the prophet himself. Turn over to chapter 3, verses 1 to 2. Hosea chapter 3. This is the command that Hosea is given from the Lord. He's told to marry a woman who will be unfaithful to him, to vow for better or for worse, till death do us part, to a woman who's going to break those vows. This unfaithful woman's name was Gomer. God tells Hosea that she's not only going to be unfaithful, but she's going to be unfaithful in the most heartbreaking of ways. Prostitution. There are hints in this book that Hosea was not a rich man, and so in the search for more money, Gomer sells her own body. And at this point, most men, almost all men, would say, fine, get out of here. But soon enough, selling her body isn't enough for her, and so she has to sell herself into slavery. And again, any man would say, good riddance. But not Hosea. Let's read chapter 3, verses 1 to 2. Then the Lord said to me, go again, love a woman who is loved by her husband, yet an adulteress. Even as the Lord loves the sons of Israel, though they turn to other gods and love raisin cakes, which is a way of worshiping idols. So I bought her for myself for 15 shekels of silver and an omer and a half of barley. Can you see what's going on here? Hosea, when he should have given up, heads down to the slave market because he found out that his wife, who sold herself into prostitution, is so desperate that now has to sell herself as a slave. He makes his way through the crowds, through all the other people bidding for these slaves. He goes up to the slave master and says, Sir, I want her. That's my wife. How much for her? Remember, he's a poor man, and usually it costs 50 shekels for a slave. So how's he going to pay? Verse 2. So I bought her for myself for 15 shekels of silver and an omer and a half of barley. How much is an omer and a half of barley? Guys, it doesn't matter. That is not the point. The point is that he gave it all. He doesn't have enough money. So he says to the slave owner, hey, I got some cash. I got 15 shekels. But I also have this food. You want to take the food? I'll give it all. This is my wife. She's mine. Please, sir. I must purchase her. She's mine. And here we have a picture of the love of God in Jesus Christ. We have a picture of Christ's love for his bride, the church, because he gave it all, even his own life, for her. Jesus Christ is ultimately the reason Hosea makes sense. God doesn't give us up because he already gave up Christ. God doesn't hand us over because he already handed over Christ to the cross. God will not execute his burning anger because he already executed it on his son. God's heart is turned over within him. All his compassions are kindled for us in spite of our sin. Because as we read in the words of Holy Scripture, God demonstrates his own love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Let's pray. Father, we rejoice that you sought us out while we were yet sinners, that you gave us hope when we had none, that you gave us your own Son, the perfect and precious Lamb, Jesus Christ, who gave it all for us. And I pray that understanding this love would move us, that it would compel us to live a holy life, to follow Christ more closely, to worship you more passionately, and to minister, to shepherd your people faithfully. I pray this in Christ's name. Amen.